You just need a 98.6, right? You just need somebody who is willing and is able. Come on, somebody say willing and able.
Willing.
The Bible says if you're willing and obedient, you see the good of the land. There's a lot of things in life that it really doesn't matter who's doing it, just as long as somebody is doing it. I need y'all to hear what I'm saying to you. Come on, let's build something. There's a lot of things in life. It really doesn't matter who's doing it, as long as somebody is doing it.
Yes.
I mean, you and I pull out of the church right now, you get, the corner of 6 or whatever it is, and you get to the stop sign. You don't care who put the stop sign there. You don't care what engineer, what construction worker. I mean, when have you pulled out of the parking lot and said, I wonder who laid this concrete and who laid this tar down here and who put these stripes? You don't care. It doesn't matter. You went to a restaurant for the most part. Maybe there can be a time when you, but for the most part, you go to a restaurant and you say, and you sit on the order, you put in there, bring your food out, and you say, which one of the cookers prepared this? Which one of the chefs? Which one asked to make dinner? Was it him? No, because most times you don't care, most times you don't know.
Right.
And for the most part, it really doesn't matter. You go through the drive through and you just get your whatever, your burger, your fries, your shake. You didn't say, who's on the grill today? Who made the lunch? You don't really care.
We don't care.
You blessed the food, most of us. You blessed the food, and you did it, and you win. There's certain things that it doesn't matter who's doing it, as long as it's getting done. Did you get that? Now, there's as you begin to graduate, and as you begin to move into other spheres and seasons of life, it begins to matter a whole lot.
Right.
Who's doing what? When.
Right.
So this is why I have to be able to grow with God. I have to be able to, allow him to expand me. And so now I get to this season, and God says, okay, JB, before you just said, whosoever will, however they get it done. Now, because of where you move into and because of greater impact and greater influence and because of this and because of that, whatever God's plan is, God says, now you can't just say whosoever. Now I need you to be like my son Jesus and say, hey, Peter. And so there's times in your life where it doesn't matter who's with you or who's against you. It doesn't matter who's helping you or who's not helping you. There's certain times or certain tasks that it really doesn't matter. But then there's other times where it matters a whole lot who's on your right and who's on your left and who's standing behind you and who's holding your hands up. Because everybody can't hold your hands up in every season. Some people can hold your hands up when you don't got a lot going on. But there's other people that when things really start opposing you, you need somebody with some depth and somebody with some content. Somebody that don't just shout because it's Sunday. Somebody that don't just carry a Bible because it's the day of service. But somebody, come on now, that understands the task and understands the opposition. Sometimes you need somebody that's been in more fights than you've been in. Come on. So they can say, God, Pastor, move upon what I got. That knows more than you, more intelligent than you, more brilliant than you, somebody with more experience, somebody with more grace, more knowledge, more anointing, more calling, somebody that's been parenting much longer than you have. This now begins to be the place where you're going to be specific about who's around you. Touch your neighbor and say, do you care about who's around you at all? Yes, there are certain seasons where it really doesn't matter per se who you're running with or what they're doing when they leave you. But then there's a season that comes up you care more about who's next. Watch this now. You care more about the private life of the person who's next to you than you do their public life. See, there's a season that you care more about who are you when you're not with me. That's what matters more than anything else. But in other seasons, you don't care what they do when they leave out of your life. Are you? Yeah, are you? Watch this. Have you gained so much? nothing. You can't be helped. You can't be encouraged. You can't be uplifted. You can't be corrected. Nobody can say he's a better way to do it because you're so full of yourself. Watch. Don't have those people too close to you. They might be in your camp, but don't have them too close to you.
That's right, Kevin.
You gotta always be pliable.
Yeah, we do.
Tell you, the Bible says a man that God spoke to Jeremiah, said, Jeremiah, come. Let me show you a work that is being worked on the wheel. And he took him down, the Bible says, to the potter's house.
Uh-huh. All right now.
And there was clay that was being formed. Now, y'all, there was some tangible substance that was being modified from what it is to what God wanted it to be. And I'm concerned that we don't have clay people in church no more. I'm concerned that we have people in church that no longer need to be molded. I'm concerned that we have leaders around us that cannot be, amen, modified from what they are to be who God called them to be, because you're so sufficient. Don't touch me. Don't tell me that. Don't correct me. No, no, no. Don't prophesy to me. Don't lay hands on me. Don't tell me how I could have did it, how I should have did it, because I did it the way that I want to do it. And I want to know, are you a clay type of believer? In the hands of the potter. And so the scripture goes on to say that it pleased him to make it again. It pleased him to start over. It pleased him, meaning God, to give him a new beginning.
Yes.
God is more excited about you starting over than you are. The Bible says it pleased God, it pleased the potter to start over. Hallelujah. I forgot who it was I was talking to. And I said, I remember now. I said, here's the misconception that people have regarding new beginnings and regarding starting over, whether starting over in a particular area in your life, starting over in business and finance, starting over in a relationship, starting over in being a believer and a Christian. Well, it doesn't matter, but people have the misconception. And here's the misconception. And I said, we've got to graduate from this. The misconception is this, that whenever I start over from zero. And that's a lie.
Amen.
We oftentimes attributed starting over to starting over with nothing and starting over at a loss and in a negative. But I'm going to tell you something. Oh, glory to God. The only way you can start from zero is if you didn't learn nothing from whatever you went through. Starting at a stronger place. Everything that you learned from that disappointment, that business deal going bad, everything you learned, amen, from whatever it was that happened, you start from there. So how in the world can you say you're starting over from zero?
Right.
Your thinking is warped.
That's good. All right.
Hear me.
Good word. I know zeros.
You had to leave this job for this, that, or whatever reason, and now you're at a new place and you're having to start over. You're not starting over. Watch this. Starting over, by definition, is much different from starting over by application.
Right.
All right, that's good.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
So we look at what we define and take that as being the application. Mm-hmm. Are y'all following me?
Uh-huh.
Yes, Lord.
That's not necessarily the case, because we hear starting over.
Right.
And what we can think is all the work.
Yeah. Yes. That's true.
Was for nothing. Uh-huh. All the time spent. Mm-hmm. All the energy.
Yeah.
All the finances. All those times was for nothing. No. That's what the Bible says. I will restore unto you the years that the cankerworm and the palmerworm and the locust have stolen and eaten up. So God says, when you start your new beginning, here's what's awesome about that. You get all the new, and I'm going to do better than what you had the last time. By yourself that somebody's supposed to be helping you do.
Mm-hmm. Right. Wow.
Now, I know some of us are like, hold on, wait a minute, I don't got good people. They don't understand my vision, they don't understand where I'm going. Hold on, God, you ain't sent anybody in my life. Hold on, before you give yourself all these excuses, and before you give yourself all these reasons, which to some extent could very well be factual.
Right.
But if I'm living by those excuses, and I'm living by that mantra that good help is.
Right.
If I'm living by that mantra, you're right. You will never find me.
Uh-huh. That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
Oh, y'all.
Amen.
I said a little earlier, let me do a little better justice with it now. God never just talks to you. He never just talks to you.
Amen.
Never.
Just talk.
He always talks to somebody else about you.
That's good.
Glory. Good God. Hallelujah.
He never just talks to you. He's always talking to somebody else about you. So here is the prophet about to die of thirst.
Right.
And the Lord says, I've talked to a widow about you.
Right.
Just like I talked to the bird a couple weeks ago.
Right.
And that bird fed you in the morning and fed you in the evening. Now hold on, Elijah. You talk to me and I talk to an animal to take care of you. God never just talks to you.
Come on, that's good.
And as long as you think that he's just talking to you, this is why you feel so isolated and feel like nobody is for you.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have an understanding that when you're down in prayer, when you're interceding, when you're crying out to God, whatever it is that you're doing, when you say amen and when you close that thing out, you have to say, now God, I don't know who you just talked to while I was talking to you, but I'm looking for this.
Come on.
Get you to stay shut up in the house all the time.
Yeah.
And you miss opportunity after opportunity after opportunity.
Yeah, you will. Good word. You will.
The Bible says a person who isolates himself seeks his own will.
Uh-huh.
Whenever you isolate yourself, you seek your own will. You seek your own desires. But see, when I'm, irregardless of the emotional condition that I'm in, I still have to avail myself to whatever God would have me to do. I can't come back to God and say, well, God, you know, I'm just not there right now. I'm not over this. So God, I haven't. God said, hold on, but here's how you're gonna get over it, Elijah.
Teach us.
You are here having a pity party, having a suicidal spirit, and ready to give up on me and give up on everybody that's been following you. I'm telling you right now, while you're in this emotional funk, get up. And going on Elisha's prophecy.
Right. Yeah.
Wait a minute. While I'm going through what I'm going through? Yes.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Because I'm going to show you that you're not by yourself.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Oh yeah, I heard the Holy Ghost. If you're waiting until you get well for things to be well, you might never get well.
Come on.
If you're waiting for things to get better, in order for things to be better. They may never get better.
That's true.
Amen.
Tap your neighbor and say, what are you waiting on?
What are you waiting on?
Do it while you're crying. Do it while you're frustrated. Do it while your emotional buckets are still there. Do it while you don't even know if people are liking you or not. I was going to talk about that Pastor Maria down in Mexico. How in the world can anybody still do that? How in the world, when you don't have means to make it in your own personal life, you're struggling with food and finances and this and the other, and you got 100 kids and whatever it is that you're having to nourish and feed and grow up and build up. What makes you look beyond your needs and look at somebody else's needs? What is it? Watch this. And if you are doing it by yourself, do it by yourself with such class that people say, there's no way I'm going to let you do that by yourself.
That's right. Right. That's right. That's good.
Amen. Yes, Lord. Oh, you're speaking good.
Single father. Every time you talk to the single father, he's just talking about, oh, I just had some help. Oh, these kids, man, they're running me crazy. I gotta always do this and do that. Single mother. Xander, you just don't understand what it is to be a single mother. Stop trying to make people who are not in your situation understand your situation. Don't make them try to understand your situation.
That's right.
That's not a prerequisite of them helping you.
Uh-huh. Yes, sir.
Wow. It's not.
Come on, grown folk. Because what I'm really asking for is your pity. But when I say that, that's what I'm asking for. I don't need your pity. I need your help.
Right.
Oh, man. See, but all I do is talk to you about what's wrong and what's happening and how I'm so burnt out, drawn, I can't do anything. Then what I'm really looking for is your pity, but your pity is not going to help me.
Right.
Right.
Your help is what's going to help me. It's not, that's why the Bible tells us when we're fasting, to not walk around like the world is ending.
Yes,
walk around like, oh, if I just can eat some of that, what you eat over there. Why you can't eat none of it? Man, I'm fasting. Man, I'm telling you. Man, no, you've done yourself nothing. You've done no spiritual good at all. You've acquired nothing in the invisible when I behave that way. It is when I want everything that's on your plate. And I just say, man, that look good. I'll get some next week. It's when I can look at what it is, but not allow what it is to make me do something that I said I would not do.
So if I
feel like I'm in a place where I'm doing it by myself, mm-hmm. then do it with such class,
yes.
and such distinction.
Right.
Watch this now. That as an example, if Noah is doing this by himself, mm-hmm. and he do it with such class and distinction, okay. and has such a great attitude about it, that you have people over here who will leave good stuff to come and be a part of what you're doing.
Yeah.
Right.
What would make, and I'm going to read, we're going to read text in a minute. What would make Jesus went to Levi, guys? Levi, Matthew, tax collector, one of the most lucrative positions in all of the New Testament.
Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
Because they got over on people.
Yes, they did.
They got over on businesses. They got over on corporations. They got over on families that couldn't even pay. You gonna pay.
Right.
You gonna pay or you give me what you're sleeping on. You gonna pay. So Levi, very lucrative. Very, very, very wealthy man. And Jesus said, follow me, and he left the business.
Right.
I said, I feel like prophesying in here, but I don't even know if y'all hear
this. Go ahead. So,
people will leave good gigs just to be with you. People will turn down something they've always wanted, or so they thought they wanted it, until they saw how you were living.
Amen.
Right.
it is fulfillment.
That's it. That's it.
But you got to be living in such a way that will make people want to be a part of what you
do.
Yes.
You have to have such an attitude about yourself, such a demeanor, such a character, such a way of doing what you do that becomes more attractive than a 401k
at
the moment.
Right.
It's not so much what you make. Mm. Not so much where you do what you do to make what you make.
Uh-huh.
I hope you got to this point, but what really matters is who you're doing it with.
Who are you doing it with?
If you've not got to that place in life, I pray that you graduate right now.
Uh-huh.
It's not so much where, it's not so much what. It will always be who.
Who. Uh-huh. Who. Amen.
Who are you doing it with? And there's some things in life you didn't get to choose exactly who you were doing certain things with.
Amen.
And then there's other things in life that God said, you choose.
Uh-huh.
Watch this. Hallelujah. For the Holy Ghost. Okay. Watch this. So I look and I say, well, I want to choose that one. I want to choose that one. I really want to choose that one. I think I tweeted this yesterday. Just because God calls you something doesn't mean you are that yet what he called you.
Right. Uh-huh. Yeah, that's right.
I can talk to you. I can get the benediction right now. Because here's where we mess up at. I want you to help me, but I need you to be all of this.
Mm-hmm.
I need to look in you and see that it's in you to be all of that. And so come on and follow me until you become it.
Right.
Yes, Lord.
Right.
See, you got to be willing to walk with imperfect, unhealthy people as they become healthy.
Right.
That's good.
Right.
So you got to go to somebody who feels like they are disqualified or unqualified and help them to understand what's in them. That you already know what's in them, even if what's in them hasn't played out
yet. That's good.
What would make Jesus call these weird people? I mean, yeah, he called doctors, he called lawyers, he called fishermen, he called people from with royal lineages, where he called people with legacies that had great spiritual, heritage, if it were. Amen. He called people that had no understanding at all. John Mark, was the youngest of all the disciples, and most theologians say that John Mark was somewhere between 16 and 18 years old when Jesus called him to be a disciple.
That's good.
And this guy got his own book.
Right.
Jesus said, I know all the people think you're just a teenager.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, I see some stuff in you. Come follow me.
Yes.
That's right.
If you're waiting for people to become it, why do they need you?
Come on, son.
You are there to help them become whatever you see in them.
Right.
That's good.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes.
Tap your neighbor and say, you ain't all that. None of us are all that.
Right.
You got some things about you that make people be like, oh, that's special. Oh, that's unique. Man, if I could do it like that. And you got some things about you that people say, ooh.
Yeah.
Amen. Hey, come on, sir.
Watch this. But you know what's priceless? Hey, what's priceless? Growing up in school, you know, this teacher talk about, one takes one bad apple. I'm not endorsing or even agreeing with that, but the theory has some weight to it. And I'd be talking to the whole world right now. I just wouldn't say it. I'd be talking to the whole world. Listen. When you're doing something by yourself and you do something wrong, everybody knows it. When you do something in a group and you do something wrong, that group is the only one that will know it.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Come on out.
Yes, sir.
Come here, Brother Dave. No, watch this for just a second. Just come out here for a moment. bring me a sticky note really quick. Just a sticky note. Just a sticky note. I need to just leave this analogy because you didn't get it. And I can't go on. Now, I'm going to show you something here. And when I show you, Noah, come up for right beside me. Eric, come right beside me. Papa Chris, come right beside me. Yeah, just put those down in the image, Mom. Now, let me stand right there for a second. Now, I don't know if this is going to stick here, but I'm going to try. I want you to imagine that this... Get harder. Let's say, what have you got to do? Let's say that this is a blemish. Now, y'all move over, Jim. Now, just standing there, everybody sees that. Everybody sees it. Everybody knows it. Maybe somebody should say something to you who don't, and maybe the person who you don't want to say something to you is the one that always.
Amen.
Like, why you had to be the one to go to say that? Watch this now. Now, gentlemen, y'all come and surround him. It's harder to see blemishes when you're working as a team. And the reason it is so easy for some people to just say so many things to you about this and that is because you're doing it by yourself.
That's good, sir.
If depending upon how close they are, depending upon what type of function they are performing or function they're doing, I gotta peel back all these layers before I can see you got a problem. What are you doing by yourself that's making everybody see your faults? Everybody has faults. The issue now is not even about the faults.
Right.
We all have them. We're all working through them.
Right.
But you control who sees them. If the neighbors know that you and your husband don't get along, it's y'all fault.
Right.
You told them. You didn't want to knock on their door, but you told them. You didn't slip them a note, but you told them. All of us have things that we're working on that we're getting through, but I'm going to tell you what's so awesome. Come on, y'all hug around him. What's so awesome is what I want. Just stoop down a little bit, Dale. What I want is I want to work in an environment with a cluster of people, that these people are covering me while I'm working on my blemishes.
Come on. Right. Yes.
They know the real deal.
Right.
Woo, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
There's going to be some people, watch this. Oh, I hear you. There's some people, let me back up. There are some things you won't get better at unless some people know what it is.
Right.
Yeah. That's right.
That's true.
Mm-hmm.
That's true.
In this case, it's 1, 2, 3, 4 that know. And Dale will come up, I should say, this lens. I don't want to, okay, yeah, put that inside there. Close it up. And Dale will walk out in front of everybody. They'll be like, man, Dale got it going. Dale's good. And Dale's like, y'all don't understand. I got something that I'm working on.
Yes.
Amen.
Hello.
Come on. And he do what he had to do, and then he go back and start working on that thing again. And he pull it back out. He don't get by himself and forget.
Right.
Okay. He goes back, go ahead, bend back down and start working on it. He's been back down. And so there's people that cover you while you're working on you.
Right.
Do you have anybody covering you while you're working on you? Woe is the person that is uncovered while they're trying to fix themselves.
Right.
Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Stay right there for just one more minute. Just stay. You can tell them, Dale, for just one second. I'll let you sit down alone. But listen, you take someone and every day they come home from work or whatever it is and they go in the garage. And all you see is them going to the garage. All you see is them going to the garage. All you see is them going to the garage. And then, amen, after about a year or a year and a half, you see them going to the garage and you see the garage door open. Mm-hmm. What's been going on in there? And they just back out, amen, a 57 Chevy that they've been working on. Amen. Watch this now. They've been working on it all this time.
Right.
All you saw was them go in.
Right.
But you didn't know that what they were doing privately was preparing them for who they were becoming. Tap your name and say, cover me while I work on me. Say, cover me while I work on me. Cover me while I work on me. I'm not trying to say that I'm all that and I'm such a mess, but what I am saying is, can you cover me while I work on me? I'm not saying cover me while I do nothing. That's not healthy. Don't cover somebody when they aren't even trying to work on what they need to work on. Don't cover somebody who's really saying sweeping under the rug. I'm talking about cover somebody who's crying and pouring out and going through counseling and getting help and medicine and to get better. You can cover those people.
Yes. Hallelujah.
You can't cover somebody who don't care about being exposed.
All right. Say it. Amen.
Let's read the scripture.
All
right. Hallelujah. Let's tie this all again. Go to Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Ecclesiastes chapter 4. Now I know you already know where we're going, but let's just begin this. Let's begin the verse 9. It says, two are better than one. Because they have a good reward for their labor. Now stop. Look at it. So your labor is multiplied the more people you have doing it with you. Mm-hmm. Now, this is not per se simply a marriage scripture. So don't just apply this to relationships in the sense of intimate relationships, boy, girl, man, woman type relationship. Does it fit that? Certainly it does. But it's not just that. Now, so oftentimes when it comes to scripture, when it comes to biblical interpretation, scripture analysis, what we do is the first bit of revelation we get, we say that's the ultimate revelation about that particular scripture, and so we stop digging. So two are better than one. Two anything.
Yes.
$2 is better than $1, praise God.
Amen.
Two shoes better than one shoe. Usually, you know, you keep going with it. Two are better than one.
Amen.
Two partners, two executives, two business people, two lawyers. Two are better than one. And it goes on to say, but they have a good return for their labor. Because now while I'm trying to dig and push, I can just dig and you push. Now I just cut my time down. I just cut my expenses down. I just cut whatever down. Just because what's this now? I don't need you to dig. I'm a good digger. I need you to push while I'm digging. So it's not about raising up people that can do what you do. You need to raise up people that can do what you can't do, or what you don't have time to do, or what you're not anointed to do, but you're anointed to do it. You sing, I'll preach. Oh, y'all don't want to get it. You lay hands, I'll go over here. staff your weakness.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Not your strength.
Wow.
That's good. That's good. Uh-huh.
Staff. You learning staff? That means bring people around you who have what you don't have.
That's good.
Maybe it's a passion, a zeal in a particular area that they have but you don't.
Mm-hmm.
If you get everybody to do the same thing you do, that's a gap. That's an opportunity. That's an opening. That's something I don't like. That's something I like, but I just don't have time to do it. This is just an unknown area that I'm not sure what God is doing. But can I get y'all? I need you to do this, and you do this, and you do this.
Okay.
I'm gonna keep doing this. But those two things right there, I don't like it. I like it, but I don't have time. I'm not even sure about that one. Watch this now. If you can handle this. I'm not even sure about this one, but I'm sure about you.
Right. Mm-hmm.
All right.
So, whatever you figure out in that area, whatever is revealed to you, whatever confidence you have is not a confidence that I'm going to have.
Right. Amen.
Folks, this is why the kingdom is unlike any other element. Because you can't do the kingdom. You can't operate in the kingdom. You can't be the kingdom without trusting people.
Amen.
And sometimes you'll trust people and they're going to hurt you. But watch this. If they're willing to make it right, that should not stop anything.
Amen.
Amen.
There is no way you can do anything big and not trust somebody. Amen. If the only person you trust is yourself, you're going to be about that important.
Yeah.
I can even go further and tell you it's not even so much. I knew we said, well, How can two walk together unless they agree? Now, if you've been going to this church any amount of time, you've heard me say before that agreement doesn't mean saying the same things.
That's good.
She can say, what's your favorite color, man? Blue. Now, blue's an okay color. So, she said blue, I say purple.
Wow.
And we can walk together in harmony.
Yeah, we can.
And we are not saying the same thing.
Amen.
And we walk in the store, and she go look for the blue sweaters and the blue jackets and the blue shirts, and I say, I'm gonna be over here. Come on, y'all follow me? And still walking together. Meet me back here, Minister Jen, in about 45. Well, no, you're a woman. You need about 2 hours and 45 minutes. I'll be back in about 10 minutes, and you'll be back in about 10 minutes. And still walking together in agreement. Agreement is not saying the same thing.
That's right.
Agreement is having the same heart.
Yeah.
Amen.
There is no agreement if the heart is not there.
Right.
If there's not a consistency of heart.
Yes. Amen.
So I can have somebody that doesn't really agree with my way, with my operation. But they're connected with my heart.
Right.
And they say, let's go forward.
Right.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Uh-huh. That's what you do. Man. Anyhow.
Oh, God. This is so good, guys. We're going to read the rest of that scripture in just a moment. I shared with the team a long time ago. I don't know. And this thing blew my mind. I had the opportunity at the beginning of this year to listen to one of the executives, one of the staff people that was on President Reagan's immediate staff when he was in office back in the late 80s, mid 80s, whatever it was, and worked directly with him, worked directly for him, and he came in and made some presentations to us. And he said, I want to share something. And he said, y'all know that great speech that Ronald Reagan is known for? Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. Now, you know, the whole Berlin Wall and the fall of Russia, and then it became whatever it is today. And he said, can I tell you how that speech happened? He said, nobody on our staff agreed with that. He said, the president, Mr. Reagan at that time, he, you know how you have your staff writers that write the scripts for you? He said, no, I want to write it. Wrote it.
Mr. Gorbachev said tear down his wall. And I think he said it twice. And he said everybody was saying to him, listen, no. This is not, why are you gonna go on national, the whole world gonna see this? Why you gotta be so this and be so that? Don't do it, just say thank you if you don't mind, maybe think about tearing down. Will you consider other options? Political, come on somebody, right? He said, no, this is the way that I'm moved to write it this way. This is me, da-da-da-da-da. And everybody disagreed, but then they said, okay, Mr. President. He went out there, said it. And to this day, it's arguably one of the top 10 addresses ever given by a U.S. president to another nation. None of his staff agreed. But when he said, this is what we're going to do, everybody jumped on board with it.
Uh-huh.
Agreement doesn't mean saying the same thing.
Amen.
But it means having the same heart.
You've
got to have the same heart.
Amen.
And this is why, yes, even when it comes to husbands and wives, and when it comes to supervisors and managers and employees, whatever it is to be, it's not about, again, saying the same thing. It's not about you agreeing with everything that your spouse or whoever it is that maybe saying something. But you have to agree in principle, in the sense of the principle thing that matters is the heart of the matter.
Mm-hmm. Yes, amen. The heart of the matter. Yes, it matters.
Two are better than one because they have a good return reward for their labor. For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falls. Ladies and gentlemen, guess what? You will fall.
Right.
Not prophesying that, not speaking. Matter of fact, I know I'm not because every one of you in here has already fallen. I've already fallen. Every one of us. But notice what it says. The scripture goes right here and says, falling is not even the problem.
Right. Not the problem.
Having nobody there with you when you fall, that's the problem. Did you see that? We look at the things that we in our society put emphasis on. So what I need to ask you is, who's around you? Who's around you when you fall? When you fall verbally? When you say something you shouldn't have said? When you did something you shouldn't have did? Who's there with you now? Because if you left just for yourself, and I'm going to tell you something. Praise God, let me just slay this sacred cow for a moment. And I'm going to tell you, and here's what religious people have done. Religious people know this. And so they'll stay connected to church or stay connected to you just so when they need help, they can call you. That should have been a few more amens on that one. But it's okay. Because there are some people that would just stay close enough.
Yeah.
I'm close enough. And don't ask nothing of me, Minister.
Right.
But I'm also close enough that if I need you, brother, guess what? I know your number, I know where you live. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Wow.
Falling is not the problem. Falling when you're by yourself, that's very difficult. Mm-hmm. That's very difficult. Because I mean, we can quote the scripture already, but ladies and gentlemen, let's be honest for a moment. Let's be real. Very few. The numbers are not as high as we would want them to be for people that can just pick themselves up on their own.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The numbers are not as high as we would want them to be of people that can just pick themselves up on their own. There are some that can. Most, ladies and gentlemen, cannot. Okay. I went through a period in my life one time, and I forgot who it was I shared this with, and I said, this thing was so bad, so intense, so horrible. I said, I know, I have a new profound, and I don't even know that. I know this is, you gotta know my heart to stay up and make it. But I said, I have a fresh understanding and perspective of those who come at the point of wanting to commit suicide. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I said, in all the Jesus that I know and that I think I got, mm-hmm. and all of the whatever my life has been, it meant nothing at this season that was so horrible. And I remember I sat down and wrote pages and pages and pages of what I was feeling, what I was going through. And every once in a while, I go back now and I just read what I wrote when I was in that very horrific season. When I look back at some of the worst times in my life, what makes me not so much focus on what happened is because I can always focus on who was there when it happened.
Right.
Mm-hmm. this is off the cuff stuff here. That's why it's not like this is my life stuff. But I'm trying to think in my life. I'm really trying to think. As an adult or as a young boy growing up, if there was literally anything that ever happened to me, and then I can say that there's absolutely nobody. Now, it might not have been who I wanted to be.
Right.
Wow. Yeah.
Right.
Oh, you started jamming just now. Y'all wasn't even ready for this. because this will say, well, if Sister Jasmine is who I need, this is who I need to help me. Mm-hmm. And the help comes in the form of Sister Deborah. I'm saying, well, but Sister Jasmine is the one who can really help me with this. Mm-hmm. You don't get to choose your help in the same. Watch this now. Especially when you have fallen.
I know that. Right.
Does it matter who reaches up their hand
right.
to pull you up? I mean, does it really, really matter?
Right.
Come on.
Right. Right.
If you can be that picky and choosy and you laying down, maybe we need to let you stay on there and get some humility for a while. So that when you stand up, you're grateful. Down and out and choosing where you're helping go. I'm talking about the cluster, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, yes, you are.
God will send some people who you don't like now, but love later.
My goodness.
Right. To that.
Wow.
God will send people that you don't like now, but you will love them later.
Love them later.
That's good, sir.
Can I go deeper?
Yes, sir.
And he'll send people that you love now.
Now you better say it.
Yeah.
You
better
say it.
I don't like it.
Come on, sir.
And just can't even look at them.
Yeah, that's the truth. Yeah.
That was real unspiritual. That didn't sound very pastoral, did it? I'm talking about life.
Real.
I'm talking about life.
Right.
Seasons change and people change.
Yeah, they do.
Yes.
There be some that will come now that I just can't connect. I just can't really get with them like I want to get with them. I just can't. It's just a block and a square. It's just not fitting in together. And over time and over prayer and over the right heart, amen. The next thing you know, amen. Now there's a merger, there's a connection, and then all of a sudden, thank you, Holy Ghost. Watch the Holy Ghost right here, guys. The same guy we just talked about named John Mark. Do you know that there's a time came in the scriptures, amen, where Paul and the apostles argued over John Mark going on a missionary journey with them. And Paul said, no, don't want him, whatever the case may be. I think it was Paul or Peter, one of the two. And then in another book, it goes on, and Paul ends his letter by saying, send John Mark, for he is helpful to me.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
But in another book earlier, he was like, no, I don't want him.
Right, right.
He deserted me, he abandoned me, he left me, whatever it was, whatever was going on. Hallelujah, praise God. And so I want to know, watch this, you know how anointed you are. Mm-hmm. Jesus Christ.
So we think with you. Think
with when you can recognize that somebody is different.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And not hold them to what they used to be or what they used
yep.
to be.
All right.
How big boy of the apostle
uh-huh.
to say, send, watch this. This letter was being read to the whole church. Mm-hmm. He didn't do it in private. The whole church heard, wait a minute, he asked for Mark. Oh, don't you remember the big falling out that happened?
Yeah, yeah.
He recognized the season that changed and that obviously there was some fruit that John Mark showed or exhibited that he is no longer that person anymore.
That's right. Gotta recognize.
The cluster. Paul could not do it by himself. Mm-hmm. He needed Timothy. He needed Titus. He needed Philemon. Amen. He needed John Mark. He needed all these ones that to work in tandem with him, to work in group. He said, guess what? I'm in prison. I don't need you to be in prison with me. You just be my runner. I'll write the letter. You go take it.
That's good.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
Yes, sir. Don't need someone to do exactly what you do. You just need them to do what you can't do.
Yeah.
Or what is it, even grown folk, honestly guys, if you can handle this, please say this. Or you just simply won't do it.
Yeah.
Right. Amen.
My mind.
Come on, guys. This is good because I'm balancing spiritual and natural together. I'm balancing the practical with the spiritual, by the way. But there are some things that you just question. That you know it got to be done, but you just simply don't want to do it.
Yeah. Right.
And if you got folks around you that say, you know what, sir, ma'am, brother, sister, you know what, I'm here to help, I'm here to serve, I'm here to just be with you. You know what? How about going to them and say, you know what? Tell me what you don't want to do, because that's where I'm starting.
That's right.
Tell me what you don't want to do, because that's where I'm starting. Tell me the thing that gets on your nerve the most, because that's where my prayer life is going to be directed.
That's what you do.
Amen.
You're talking about the cluster.
Amen.
How can you cover somebody? How can you handle? How can you get closer, be more intimate? Remember I said to the Wednesday night folks, past Wednesday, that intimacy means information. The only way that closeness is going to come is through information. And then you have to choose, what am I going to do with this information that I have? Bless you. What am I going to do with this information that I have? I can take this information and ruin you. I can take this information and spread a rumor on you, spread gossip on you. I can take this information and say, well, I'm going to tell you, Minister so-and-so, he ain't all of that.
Right, just get your own
shit.
That's true.
Right, come on now. Because what you can do with it. When the Bible says, amen, hear the faithful least, the faithful and much. And sometimes people will just give you a little drop of this, a little drop of this. And if you tell one person, sometimes you can't even tell your spouse because God is testing you.
That's right.
Come on, I hear your thoughts, but Lord, well, hold on now, I'm mad. I'm supposed to tell them everything. No, this is why you need to be living a life of following God, that you can be able to go to your spouse and say, baby, here is something the Lord has told me to keep in silence. And so when the time comes, I'll be able to reveal that to you.
Right.
I'm
yeah.
so
right.
thankful that you trust me and that
right.
I trust you. Hallelujah.
Right.
Wow.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
Now I know most of you are saying, it don't work like that, sir.
Amen.
Listen, watch this now. Here's what I'm telling you. Doesn't mean that it should.
Right.
Good.
We're getting there, we're getting there.
Doesn't mean that it should. This is significant. I heard one of my managers say this at the office, and it was so good. It was so simple, but it was so good. We had made some decisions as a leadership team there at the office. And we said, hey, we're gonna get a formal announcement, a formal communication, stuff that we need to do. And then like 2 days later, we came back in the staff meeting and it was like, yeah, pretty much the whole department knew what was going on and what was happening. And one of the managers said, you know what? He said, why do we send emails? Why do we have our conference calls? Why do we do this? He was like, the grapevine works better than anything else. And I was just like, you know what, man? You exactly right. And sometimes like the harder you try to keep something.
Uh-huh. That's good. That's good.
What's this? The grapevine. Things matriculate at such a rate and such a pace. Grapevine. The grapevine is a system.
Yes. Yes, it is.
A communication system. It's a means of transport. Transport information. Transport prayers. Transport words. Transport the heart of God concerning the matter.
Yeah.
So Jesus takes time to John chapter 14 and talking to us about this mind. And how he is the vine.
Yes.
And he said to every one of us, we are the branches. And he said his Father, who is in heaven, is the vine dresser. He tends to it, he keeps it, he prunes, he cuts back, he does whatever is needed so that there can be more, if it were a grapevine, grapes, or I'll just be more generic and perhaps more applicable, more fruit on the vine. Notice, he said you and I are the branches.
Right.
Leaves grow automatically depending on the season.
Mm-hmm.
It takes work to have fruit.
Yeah,
that's true. So if you're a branch in here and there's nothing but leaves on you, whoop-de-doo. What separates the branches is whether there's leaves or whether there's fruit.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
What's interesting is, you mentioned earlier, I'm Selena, Jesus cursed the fig tree. Not because there wasn't leaves on it. Because there were leaves. The Bible said there was only limbs. But there was no fruit. There was no figs. It's easier to have fruit in a company of fruitful people. It's harder to have fruit in a company of folks
good right there.
That either don't care about fruit, don't have fruit,
that's
don't
good.
Want fruit, or want a different type of fruit.
Right.
They
want to
choose.
This is important, church. This is very important. Some things you can't choose, some things you can choose. And what you choose is either going to make you or break you.
Yeah, it will. Yeah, it will.
Let me read a scripture and give you this illustration. You got Ecclesiastes 4 and 9, that's great. Look at Deuteronomy 32. I won't preach these, I just read them, but I want to read Deuteronomy 32. And guys, I'm just going to look at one or two verses here, if you would. Look at verse 30. How can one chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to flight, except their rock has sold them and the Lord has shut them up? For their rock is not as our rock. I want you to hang up on this. One chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to flight. How can that happen? Multiplication. There is strength in numbers, even if it's the wrong numbers. If you got a lot of people doing the wrong thing, guys, that's important.
Yeah.
That is important. When you have a lot of people doing the right thing, that is important. Numbers matter. There's a whole book called Numbers. They matter. Whether numbers against you or numbers for you.
Yes, yes.
How much you have and how much you don't have matters.
Right.
Yes.
Who's in your life and who's not in your life matters.
That, yes. It all matters.
One chase 1,000. How can, my mind can't. I can't comprehend 1,000 people looking over there and seeing one and saying, God, let's get out of here. I can't, my mind wouldn't even let me go there because it seems so irrational, so just ludicrous, just insane, just what? I mean, even if he got the biggest, baddest gun, some of us gonna die, but ain't no way. Ain't no way he's gonna get all of us.
Right.
10 of us, 20 of us, amen, marching on. Amen, you're gonna die for a good cause. But amen, the other 990 of us.
Sorry.
And then he said two. Natural mind will put 2,000 in flight. Right. Not the case. The more the cluster builds, it doesn't add. It multiplies. So when if I'm praying and I say, Prophet Leona, please agree with me on this, let's pray together on this, I didn't just add one person to help
me. You better say something up in there.
Good God have mercy. I just now, there's now another 9,000 that's got to run because she's joining in prayer with me. For a moment, grown folk. Knowing this, aside from personal private time, why would you ever pray by yourself?
Yeah, that's good right there.
Right.
That's right.
Notice that, aside from personal private time, when you show up in your closet, whatever, 5 o'clock in the morning, whatever gets this is about, whatever, that time we understand is good and essential. Jesus went off to pray. Amen. But apart from that, why would you always want somebody to agree with me?
Right.
Why do you think we always say, join hands, let's pray? Why do you think we sometimes break up in twos and say, just believe in each other? Because something happens when you get somebody else. I know you want to break through, and you're bad by yourself. But you get another sister or another brother, then watch this now. Just start praying the same thing. Oh, and God forbid you start praying at the same time. Oh, over the same issue. And now I'm
my fervor and the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man or woman will avail. Maybe some things haven't happened yet because you don't got enough people praying about the same thing. You don't got enough people believing for your health, your healing. You don't got enough people believing, amen, that your family will be restored. You don't got enough people believing that your marriage can come up out of the dump. Oh, but you think you bad by yourself. Oh, but when you lock hands with somebody else, two are better than one. It's the cluster that has a blessing in it. It's the cluster. It's the cluster. Somebody say cluster, cluster. Come on. It's the cluster. Say somebody. Tell somebody. It's the cluster.
It's the cluster. And sometimes that means I gotta tell you my weakness if you're gonna pray for me.
That's right, that's right, that's right.
And so for some of us, that's why we don't ask somebody to pray with us. Because I don't wanna tell you, I gotta follow my mouth.
Right.
I gotta follow my old habits. I gotta follow with still picking up the bottle too much. And so I don't wanna tell you that.
Right.
Because then you might look at me such and such.
Right.
But watch this now. If you still got an ego, you can't get a breakthrough.
Come on.
When you don't care who knows, and you don't care how they know, but I'm gonna get a breakthrough in this area. I'm gonna come out. My children are not gonna deal with this. Come on. No. I'm coming out of this because somebody's gonna. Jesus walked in there and said, Thomas, I'm showing you my wounds.
Yes.
I'm showing you where I'm wounded and where I'm hurt and where I've had some bad things happen to me.
My God.
Wow.
I think I tweeted this last week. A lot of people talk about their gifts, but very few people talk about their wounds.
Right.
Yeah.
Watch this. Your gift is made known to everybody. See your gift.
Right.
Singing,
right.
Preaching, teaching, administrating, organizing, leading, whatever that gift is. But your wounds.
Yeah.
That's good.
It's a whole different category.
That's right.
So yes, there are some things, if you want to have somebody agree with you, you got to tell them.
Right.
There are some things you have to tell them. I know, just let the Lord lead you. Sometimes, but y'all, no, sometimes it's just pride too. Sometimes it's just pride. But you gotta have somebody that can trust, watch this now, not just trust your gift, someone that can trust your weakness.
Right, yes.
Or should I say trust you in your times of weakness? That's significant. So, I said I was gonna preach all this. So one chase 1,000, two put 10,000 to flight. You're in Deuteronomy, now flip over now to, amen, Leviticus. Come on, keep that close right here. Leviticus. Just go back two books. Leviticus 26, church.
Yeah. Amen.
Now, guys, I love this. The numbers are a little bit different, but I love it. Jesus. God, this is all cool. Let's get it, verse 1. You shall make no idols, no graven images, neither rear up any standing image, neither shall you set up any image of stone in your land to bow down to it, for I am the Lord your God. Ye shall keep my Sabbaths, you shall reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. If you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and do them, then will I give you rain in due season, and the land shall yield her increase, and the trees of the field shall yield their fruit, and your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing time. And you shall, now let me read it again. And your threshing shall reach unto the vintage, and the vintage shall reach unto the sowing. What he's basically saying there is that the time of sowing and the time of harvesting will begin to be so expansive that they connect. In other words, as fast as you sow it over here, you're reaping a harvest over here. You just gave on Sunday, and now June 1st comes, and all of a sudden your whole world changes. I know there is Genesis 8 talks about seed time and harvest, and certainly that's biblical and that's principle, and certainly if a lot of our seeds, that's the way that it would be. We will sow it, and then we have to give God time and let process work itself out. But there's other seasons that you will come into that you are so obedient, and you are so timely, and you are so intentional that as soon as you say it, it starts happening. Can I get somebody in here to understand what I'm saying? As soon as you start believing it, it starts coming to pass. As soon as you start dancing over it and shouting over it, what you've been shouting over begins to manifest. I'm going to talk to somebody who says, I don't got time to wait 10 years for it to happen. I got to pray now, and it got to happen now. I got to prophesy now, and it got to happen now. So God, it's all hallelujah.
really connected like I say I'm connected. Let it happen now. If I'm really in covenant, God, like I believe I'm in covenant, let it happen now.
Yes, sir.
Right now.
Right now.
I don't know about you, but wait 10 years, wait 5 years, wait 20 years.
Right.
Watch this. I'm praying now because I need it now.
Right.
Come on, everybody look at it.
Right.
Y'all like, y'all ain't got no prayer things.
Right.
I'll pray now.
Right.
Because I need it now.
Right. Yes.
If I need it later, I'll pray later.
Right.
Right.
Yes, Lord.
Easy to move now.
Yeah.
Oh, man, you're really sick. Show up now, God. It's not tomorrow, but God, it is today. Hallelujah. Now I know why the Bible says, amen. If you hear his voice, harden not your heart. The day that you hear his voice, but God, this is the day that I know you have made, and I'm rejoicing in it. And my rejoicing is going to lead me to pray, to decree, to speak. I want somebody praying for me that when they pray, they say, okay, watch this. If it works, forgive me for a moment, Mrs. Yeah, I know I messaged you a lot. I'm sorry, you're in the front row. So it's like, hey, I'm praying and believing for finances, and they finish praying, and they say, open up your pocketbook.
Come on.
And then check your checkbook. Make sure you're sure. Check your phone. Yeah. Send you, go home and check your mail. I'm telling you, as soon as you finish praying, you just start looking. The Lord was always there. And God says, well, before you call unto me, I will show you great and mighty things. Which you ain't even got time to say amen, and it's already happened. I'm trying to start something, man. I'm trying to start something. Some of y'all got some wet wood. I got to burn a little bit brighter. Come on.
Jesus.
Got time to pray all night about one issue?
That.
Yes,
sir. Right now, God. Right now, Lord.
God. Ooh, Jesus.
My God.
Believe me now, I'll do it now.
Uh-huh.
Come on, how many people in the Bible? The Bible says at the self-same hour.
Uh-huh.
The same hour that they spoke and prayed and believed it, it happened.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
Maybe some things take a long time because we expect them to take a long time.
Yeah. Wow.
Come on. Well, it took them 7 years to get it. It took them 4 years to get it, so God, I need at least let it think it's gonna be years. And I said, hold on, since who? They were disobedient, that's why it took that long. Oh, if you obedient.
is,
Glory,
we've been waiting for so long to get whatever it is that we're believing, hoping, praying for, that our waiting for so long has become normal. But I'm trying to interrupt your normal. The way my wife and I do, we say it's time to start a new norm. It's time to not just pray and wait. It's time to pray and see. Oh, God, have mercy.
Gives the ear.
start experiencing the power. Yeah. And the sanctity.
In this city, in this ministry, in these people's lives, in the
Be not weary in well doing. For you shall reap if you faint not. It's hard to faint when you're in the cluster. Today was just the foundation. We'll do better in dissecting the text that we read in Isaiah 65. It says there is a blessing in it. That means there's some things you can only get in the cluster. There's certain things that only reside in the cluster. And it's that place where we're desiring to be. I'm asking right there where you are. Bow your heads. You give your all, then you will see that God has already been given his all. It's hard to see the hand of God when I'm not giving everything that I can give to him. In the sense of my heart, my time, my energy. And as you embrace this covenant word, which will cause you to get more in the cluster, in the group, in the team, whatever it is that you belong, don't just belong. Don't just belong. Make your presence felt by your heart, your spirit.
Yes, yes.
Make your presence felt by your participation.
Yes.
The Bible says that the enemy is the accuser of the brethren.
Yes, yes.
In other words, anything that he can do to divide the cluster, to divide the family, to divide a ministry, a church, a team, a relationship, to divide a marriage, he'll do it. And here's why he would try to divide, because he knows that the cluster is where the blessing is. So now, Lord, for these men, for these women, who are not heroes only.
Yes. Yes.
Father, I'm praying right now of doers.
Doers.
Praying right now and agreeing with those who will walk out.
Yes.
What they just experienced. In the smallest of ways, and even in the greatest of ways. We thank you for that.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
God, I pray that on this week, this message, this word about the cluster and about coming together and about numbers and about, it's not about one person, but it's about all those with whom that one person has been called to.
Yes. Yes.
Keep your head bowed, we are closing. But when I was a young man in the gospel, just got saved, I used to always state that whenever I sinned, it only affected me. And as I grew up in God, I realized that that too was a lie. Sin never just affects one person.
Never.
So I just pray that God will just help us to understand how much our actions and our inactions affect all that we're connected to. Jesus had 12 and he said one of them was a devil. But he didn't abandon the 11 because one of them was a devil. He kept the cluster together. He kept the group together. Even so, Father, may we have that type of unity, that type of togetherness, and that type of brotherly love. Maybe just reach over and touch somebody around you. Just touch them, hold their hand, hand on the shoulder, however you're going to do this. Just touch somebody around you. Yourself. Don't be fooled into thinking that you can. Everybody needs to be encouraged sometime, uplifted sometime, helped sometime. And I would even encourage you, if you can, to spread that help out. Don't always go back to the same person to get help. Because then eventually you'll go back to that person and they're going to have nothing else to offer. Because you've just been taking in so much, you haven't been giving anything. You haven't been replenishing anything. And that's how good wells can go bad.
Yes, say that.
It's called a cluster because God wants to be able to have more than one way that you can get help.
Amen.
And more than one person that can help you.
Yes.
And I just pray just in this moment. It's not even so much a pray. I'm just speaking in this moment. That you will realize the multiple facets and the multiple ways in which our Heavenly Father nourishes us and satisfies us and takes care of us.
Yes.
And I just pray, God, an abundance of resources. That when one well dries up, they got three others. When one river or brook dries up, God, that another one just manifests itself. So your people will never be without. I declare that over their lives
today.
That we'll be in the cluster and we'll stay in the cluster. In the mighty name of Jesus. Church, before we clap, I just encourage you to listen. Doing things for my own benefit per se. But guys, what we started on last Wednesday, who is God?
Yes.
We think we know him.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you have to do to alter your schedules to be here on Wednesday. You know, sometimes some people leave right from work. Sometimes people have to come right in from work. And sometimes people have to leave a little earlier and this type of thing. God, I don't care about you coming to hear me. It has nothing to do with it. Man, God is talking. Now, I'm challenging you to do what you can to be a part of the Wednesday night service as well. You know what I mean? There's some people I know, Minister Gina, they work on second shift and they call in to the service and just have somebody have their phone on while they're, but they don't want to miss it. And I want to just tell you, who is God is so significant. And that's where we are. We have our new Wednesday night series that we just started. And I want you to know exactly who he is, not just what the Bible says about him, but I want you to know him. Knowing him keeps you when you can't come to church. But if I don't know him, then church has to be the fullness of what I know about him.
Right, yeah.
So I challenge you with that. Greater Faith, love y'all so much. Have an outstanding week. God bless y'all.